If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly. If you can hear my voice and see the picture, you have everything you need. The event will begin shortly.
Welcome back to Book Break. This month, I'm chatting to debut novelists Juliet West and Robin Black. Hello and welcome back. I'm Alex Heminsley and this is Book Break. This month I am joined by two wonderful writers to talk about their debut novels, Robin Black and Juliet West. Welcome to the Book Break snug, ladies. Robin Black joins us from Philadelphia today to celebrate the launch of her first novel, Life Drawing. Before Life Drawing, Robin wrote a collection of essays and short stories, some of which were published by the likes of Oprah Magazine and the New York Times Magazine. And joining her on the sofa is Juliet West, who, until her novel Before the Fall, was writing poetry and short stories, one of which won the H.E. Bates Short Story Prize. Go. It's all go today. Also on this month's show, the author of Burial Rites, Hannah Kent, talks us through her writer's room. Hannah's novel, which has had rave reviews, explores the last execution in Iceland and has a fantastic female lead character. And coming up later, our fourth lady novelist, Sarah Rayner, will face our quickfire questions. So, welcome, ladies. I'm excited to get chatting. Now, we've got lots of similarities here and some differences. I would like to start with you, Robin. So you've made the move from short stories, which were kind of acclaimed and big, and you had a collection, to a novel. Yes. Was it a conscious decision? Were you kind of taking the long run up to doing a novel, or did you sort of enjoy short stories and then think, maybe there's more out there?
There's a little bit of a combination of both, and I should say it was in some ways a very long run-up because first I wrote a bad novel, and then had to put that one away, and what we at least call in the States a learner novel, mm-hmm. like a learner permit. And then there was a break where I tried to figure out the form a little bit better, and then ended up feeling very comfortable with it. Mm-hmm. I thought in the lead up to it, I kept saying things like, "I'm really just a short story writer. I shouldn't even be doing this. I shouldn't attempt it." And now, the day I finished the novel, I thought, "Oh, I can't wait to write the next novel." So it was a transition.
Yeah, and Juliet, you made the leap as well. You've done short stories, but also poetry.
Yes.
So are they three different disciplines, or are they two? Do you just see writing as writing? I can't imagine.
Right, no, I do see them as three different disciplines, actually. I think there are so many differences. One is with poetry, I'll always write just with a pen and paper. Mm-hmm. Eventually it will go onto screen. A short story is just joy. I mean, it might not go mm-hmm. well all the time, but I enjoy writing them.
Yeah.
There's a very definite end, mm-hmm. and it's not taking too long. A novel is such a huge investment in time.
Yeah.
There's a lot of fear there with a novel, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, the fear isn't there with poetry or short stories, mm-hmm. but it is with a novel.
So it's almost like a different mood that you have. You get a character,
yes.
and you think, oh, I think she'd work in a short story, or, oh, no, he's going in a novel one day. Or...
Yeah, I think there is something in that, actually. Yeah, someone that... Well, in my novel, they were characters from a real story, and mm-hmm. I just felt that that story needed to be explored in a novel form, definitely not a short story.
I should introduce a little bit, because there's lots of similarities. There's lots of differences, but lots of similarities beyond just the short story leap. You're basically both writing about long-term marriages, about mm. kind of commitment, but beyond that sort of, and then there's the guy and the girl, and it all works mm. out, right? You're going deeper, you're exploring more, but we've got sort of modern day and America here. It's much more kind of contemporary, current ideas of a couple. And you're Juliet, you're set in the First World War,
yes,
so
yeah.
you're doing the same thing thematically, but from very different angles. Mm-hmm. And you're also sort of balancing ideas of intimacy with isolation.
Mm-hmm.
So if I could just ask you, Robin, was that a sort of deliberate contrast that you did you set out to put them against each other, or did it sort of end up like, oh, these are people trying to do one thing and being another?
I think that for me it was very much, I think you're right on target, that it was very much about the isolation within an intimate relationship, mm-hmm. that was in some ways the kernel of the novel for me, was exploring what happens over years and years and years, the degree to which you can feel like one unit, but mm-hmm. then have these sudden moments of realizing, oh, but we actually want very different things. Oh, but we want the same things. And just kind of playing with that line of where it feels like you've melded into one person and where it
yeah.
suddenly feels like, wait, we actually are two very separate beings with different needs, and so
yeah.
that was very much at the heart of it.
And there's the physical isolation as well, because your characters have they're a couple. Is it their 50s? Isn't it?
She's late 40s.
Yeah.
He's early 50s.
And they've sort of come into a little bit of money and bought this house to go and sort of pursue their creative dream. And they're living in the countryside, very kind of physically isolated. And then there's a neighbour.
Yes. And then there's
who really puts the cat amongst the pigeons. So there's this sense of physical isolation which is disrupted physically and emotionally.
And I think that for me, in a sense, the physical isolation was a kind of replication of marriage, in this idea that they try to build a kind of paradise mm. where they're completely set off, which is sort of what marriages are also. I mean, you think we're building this world that's completely separate from everybody else. And always with the book, the idea was what happens when the intrusion comes. And it, you know, it's an old, old story. It's the serpent in Eden. It's the stranger comes to town. But it was very much that question of, can you create a utopian existence and having the physical setting of it as well as the emotional?
Yeah. And you have, I mean, I'm not just asking this because Alison, the neighbour in your novel, is British and you're over here now. But were there characters, did the novel begin with those characters, with one of the three? Or was it themes? Did you want to explore these emotions and find people that you could express them through? Or did you have, like, like, oh, I know an Alison.
No, I know almost nothing about anything I write until it's on the page. I mean, I don't do outlines, I don't plan. And in fact, the first paragraph of this book was originally the first paragraph of something else that wasn't working. And a friend of mine said, well, is there anything you like about it? And I said, well, I sort of like the first paragraph. So I picked it up and moved it. And so the book really began with an image, which is in that paragraph, of a man walking between two women and between two homes. And that was really the starting point.
That's fascinating to me, because when I arrived here, the first thing I said to you was how I could instantly tell you'd worked on short stories, because I was so in that book within a page. Nice. And the idea that it came from somewhere else, that's intriguing to me. I felt so comfortable with this guy walking, and wow, that's amazing. Mm-hmm. And with the sense of place is strong in this book. Is it a chicken or the egg? Did you choose that place because you knew it and you felt, now this is going to reflect how these people are feeling? Or had you been kind of visiting and thinking, when am I going to find some people I can really make use of this lovely landscape with?
I think it's more that they live in the country, and I think I discovered as I was writing the book that I've always wanted to live in the country. And I went back to my story collection and I counted off how many of them also take place in bucolic settings, rural settings. And so a lot of it was just pure fantasy of, you know, I want the old farmhouse in the country and I want the pond and I want this. And so it was not an actual place.
A Martha Stewart living fantasy that's gone a bit off the rails into something a little darker.
Little Martha Stewart meets Greek tragedy somehow.
Oh, I like that. I think we'll be using that in future. Thank you. Now then, it's time for the writer's room. And this month it's the author of Burial Rites, Hannah Kent. We caught up with her to learn about her writing process and how she crafted her debut novel. Burial Rites in a converted walk-in wardrobe in Melbourne, which was sort of my first proper office, and I loved it because it meant I could close the door at the end of the day and sort of leave my work there rather than having sort of my desk in my room in my share house and always being kind of confronted with it. And to this day, I still need a separate sort of study to work in. I much prefer working from home, not because I sort of get distracted by noises or, I quite like working in cafes, for instance, but I find it difficult to do because I need to talk aloud a huge amount when I'm writing. You know, I need to hear the words and hear the rhythm of sentences and also try out the dialogue, especially I think in a sort of an historical sense, you need to make sure that it doesn't sound too anachronistic. And so I basically, when I write, I mutter aloud to myself and I no longer know when I'm doing it. So if I work in a public place, I tend to get quite a few weird looks. I really like working in my pyjamas. I often, get changed to a fresh set in the day, so don't worry, it's not too sort of gross. But I like to be comfortable in that way. I have this hideous jumper. Oh, I shouldn't say hideous, she might see this. My mother knitted it for me. But it's really big and it's really fluffy and I probably wouldn't wear it out in public. But I like to wear that, and then my cat likes to come and sit on my lap as I write, and I quite like the company of her. I really didn't know how to go about writing a book because I'd never done it before. So there was a period for probably about 2 or 3 months where I would experiment and try a whole different kind of approaches, whether I worked best at night or whether I should sit down in the morning, whether I should just write whether I feel like it, things like that. But I ended up realizing that I'm a morning person and that I was most productive and I feel most creative as well, probably, from about 7:30 onwards. So these days, whenever I'm sitting down and actually trying to get some work done, I'll sort of make sure that I'm at my desk no later than sort of 8 o'clock. I need to have a big sort of cup of coffee. That's, part of the ritual as well. And then I try to sort of work not so much to time. So long as I'm there by that start time, it's more just about, accomplishing a certain amount of words or, finishing a particular scene. And then once I feel that I've done that and I've sort of carried on the momentum of a book or a piece of work, then I'm sort of free to go off and do other things. Thank you to Hannah Kent there. I'm ever fascinated in writers' rooms and regimes. Juliet, do you have anywhere specific or any specific things that you need when you're having a big writing day?
Yeah, I mean, I've got a bit more than a cupboard now, sort of spare bedroom that I write in. And pajamas are involved, jogging bottoms that are really baggy at the knees, and, you know, I have to be really comfortable, actually, and warm, so hot water bottles, that kind of thing.
Not a stiff breeze to kind of keep you awake. You need to be kind of cosy.
If I've got cold feet, then I can't really write.
And Robin, how about you? Do you have a sort of lovely view of a man walking across the field?
I do sometimes, just because of where my living room is, but I don't have a study or an office, and because I've tried to have them and I don't use them, I'm a wanderer.
You're a laptop.
Yeah, I'm a laptop person who just sort of, this couch looks good today, this chair looks good today, ooh, today I don't have to get out of bed, that's nice, I can work.
So you fear the rot.
Yeah, and I have oddities. Sometimes at certain points in writing I'll put a song on an endless loop and just have it going all day, and sometimes I'll have the news on, I'm completely unstructured. I have no routine.
Oh, so similar to how you have kind of unstructured plot at the beginning of writing, so you're very instinctive.
Yes, and my house is messy too. It all ties together somehow.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Thank you. Now, Juliet, as discussed, we're still on similar themes with your novel of sort of loneliness and closeness within a marriage, but you've got physical separation because you're in World War One, and Hannah, your wife, is at home in London, and Daniel is obviously not there because he's gone to war. Mm. Did you choose that era because of the sort of a canny marketing idea of the anniversary, or was it the idea of wartime separation that fascinated you, or did you find a nugget of research that caught your imagination?
Yes, actually, it was the last option. Years ago, in 1996, I was working as a journalist, and I was asked to help research a feature which was about this story. And so for, you know, 10, 12, 15 years, it was always there, and when I became a mother myself, I felt even more haunted, really, by this story. I knew that the centenary of the First World War was sort of coming up, and so perhaps that did partly inspire me. And so, yeah, I started the research 3 or 4 years ago and finally began to write.
Did you enjoy the research? Did you kind of get lost in it and really kind of anchor yourself to it? Because there's a huge sense of place, but unlike with the sort of Americana fantasy setting, this is like street by street within London, isn't it?
Yes.
There's a sense that facts are behind it.
I really, because it is based on the true story, although I have fictionalised it and the names are fictional names, I did really want to anchor it in those places and those streets, and I walked to them. I mean, it's vastly changed now because of the Second World War Blitz, but no, absolutely, I wanted that sense of place there.
Yeah, and did you kind of, where did you let yourself have creative license? Because it's an intimate, so it's the story of a marriage.
Yes, a woman whose husband is fighting but is tempted, falls in love with another man, which is, as you can imagine, a hugely dangerous sort of betrayal at that time.
Yeah, and on different levels as well.
Yes.
I mean, society was different, marriage was different.
Absolutely.
It was a war, concentrate, guys.
Yes. Exactly, yeah, I think... And I'm absolutely sure she would have been well aware of the risks that she was taking. Mm-hmm. It's something that fascinated me for a long time. I'm interested in history anyway. My degree was in history. Mm-hmm. So the research was just joy for me. I loved it. And it was more a case of dragging myself away from the research and putting pen to paper.
What was the research? Where was it that you... Was it old newspapers?
Yes, there was quite a bit of that. The internet obviously is incredible, but to go into actual archives, there's a wonderful place called the Island History Trust, which is on the Isle of Dogs, and they've collated an amazing archive of old photographs.
Specific to that area.
Absolutely.
Because that's the bit that really sort of...
Yeah, so photographs were hugely inspirational, actually. Mm. Yeah.
And Hannah, who's your sort of wife character, was there a sense of the person that that's based on, or did you just find facts and then impose? Did you kind of let your imagination run there, or were you like, oh, I see, she was this kind of a person?
Right, it was a bit of both, because this story, there are a lot of police documents and inquest documents, without giving too much away, relating to the case. So there was a lot of contemporary evidence relating to the case, which described her character as sober, respectable and hardworking, which sort of really went against what, you know, so that really intrigued me, how someone who had this sort of facade of, you know, working class respectability really sort of took this quite quite risky route. So I had that hint of her character, but I did have to, of course, try and sort of construct a personality.
And how did it feel sort of for you as a writer, kind of emotionally going, taking that, you know, you've described already how much of a sort of larger leap it is to go for the novel. Was it quite reassuring to have this sort of anchor of reality, of some facts, like, I can't waste too long on this because I need to get back to my research document? Or did you get frustrated and think, well, next time I'm going to have a dragon in there? And did you, like, how?
It's funny, it's a great question, because it is a bit of both. You know, at times you want to have more creative license, and then you think, no, I have to be true to the story. So a mixture. But my second novel, which I'm writing now, I haven't based on a true story.
Right.
I mean, it's historical, and there are historical elements that are true in there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I wanted a bit more freedom this time, as Robin was saying, to start and not really know where it was going to end.
They really are fantastic companion pieces because of the similarities and differences. Anyway, now it's time for questions. Sarah Rayner takes on our quickfire questions this month. Here she is.
I think nothing kind of has the impact like those books from when you're really small. So either Mrs. Tiggywinkle or Anne of Green Gables. And I'm going to go for Anne of Green Gables. I've got this, I actually live down in Brighton, and I've got this little bench that I sit on overlooking the South Downs, where the vista is absolutely stunning, and you can see right out over the plain as far as the North Downs. So there. The Silent Wife was the last book. To read it since yesterday, but the one that won the Costa Prize, because it's about a subject that I'm really interested in, about the boy with schizophrenia. So that one. But books that have certainly kind of broadened my perspective and human understanding. So The Curious Incident of a Dog in the Nighttime would be one.
And thank you to Sarah Rayner there. The book that she mentioned, the Costa one, was The Shock of the Fall by Nathaniel Filer. Have either of you read that? Has that come not reached the States?
I've bought it. I haven't read it yet.
It's been exciting to see, because the Costa kind of really did that thing of making an author who sort of slipped by otherwise.
Yeah.
And she talked about her, it was Anne of Green Gables for Sarah, and we've had a question from Twitter from Alison Percival, who asked the same thing of you two, which is, what is your most influential childhood book? Can we have Robin first?
I have to go with Little Women.
Yeah.
I have to. I think it was probably the first book I read that was really a novel, as opposed to a storybook or, you know, a kid's book. And it was shocking, because it wasn't an entirely happy book.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, it may have absolutely set my course as a writer of not entirely happy books.
Mm.
But the idea that you could, I think I must have been 8 or 9, and the idea that they weren't just for fun, that you could actually learn about people and that you could
read.
And ideas and grief. I mean, because I think children know about that, but they don't see it in books. At least they didn't in the 1960s and 70s.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a real mind-altering experience.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. How about you, Juliet? Do you?
Yeah, I mean, predictably, I did read a lot of Enid Blyton.
Yeah,
but I think
I actually did as well.
Unpredictably. Yes. I think, in a way, her novels or her children's books sort of slightly meld into one.
Yes.
The standout book for me I would say Danny the Champion of the World, Roald Dahl.
Yeah.
I can just remember being in bed when they're drugging the pheasants and just absolutely riveted by it.
And Roald Dahl is extraordinary in that, I mean, kind of unlike Enid Blyton, where some stuff happens, he really takes childhood terrors and makes them manageable or exciting. And I remember reading with my brother some of Danny the Champion of the World and other ones. And again, they do, they kind of, they serve a function like Little Women, I suppose.
And there's a bit of, you know, naughtiness there because it's sort of slightly on the side of the poachers. And, you know, it sort of just seems really very different.
Well, I mean, we've crossed that one off, but that's about all we've got time for this month. My thanks to Robin and Juliet for joining me. And if you want to get in touch with the programme in the future, you can contact us on Twitter with any book-related questions. If you want to find out more about any of the books that Pan Macmillan publish, you can go to their website, which is www.panmacmillan.com. And if you want to watch any part of the show on an on-demand version, it will be available shortly. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. And thanks again to all the ladies this month. We will be back next month with some more book chat. See you then. Goodbye.